Yes, it's last, true.
Last time, where did we stop?
My name is Nguyen Khoa.
Okay, I know. But now my next question is, when did we stop last time? Please tell me. Okay, Khoa, I can hear you.
Sorry, sir. My microphone is some problem.
No, okay, Hill? Hill?
Yes, yes.
Last time, where did we stop?
We stopped at ways of adjusting capacity.
Okay. We stop for here after this one, and I skip the waiting line. Then I talk a little about this one, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now we come back to the waiting line because it's really important. As I introduced to you last time, that there are some tools that help us to calculate the capacity of the systems. For stochastic systems, not deterministic like before. These are waiting lines for the kind of not so simple, but it's quite simple systems. The other tool is simulation for complex systems, for the big systems, okay, for waiting line is more popular because can apply for many cases. But simulation is normally we apply for design the complicated system like airport, like railway station, like bus system, and so on. These trees we apply for the case. We concerned about the market, the competition from the competitors on source. Therefore, here simulation you study in simulation subject. Therefore, I don't teach you. I only teach you the most popular one in the waiting line system. And for waiting lines, normally. We will consider about the case of a queue. A queue is served by one or many servers. Okay, here, for example, we have a queue of customer, and it will serve by one server. That system we call that single server, single phase. We need to define the capacity of the system. It means that for this server, how many customers it can serve for, let's say that in a period of time. Let's say that in 1 hour or in 1 year, like the airport, the queue number of people can be served without waiting for so long. Okay, that's the capacity of the system. It means that the length of queue and the number of customers to be served in one period of time. That's the capacity of the whole system. The other one, it could be the serial system in which the customer are served by two or more servers setting up in a serial way. We call that single server multi-phases. Then the way of calculate serial system actually is just duplicate the way of single servers and single phase. Then the other thing, other system like the bank office, we have multiple servers and one queue systems. Okay. Then we have to calculate how many server could be used, and if we know the number of server already, we need to calculate one server can serve for how many customer in an hour, or vice versa. If we know that in 1 hour how many customer arrive, we can come out the number of server. Okay, and we also have to calculate the queue length also. The other case, if we organize the system by multiple queue served by multiple server, this one is parallel system, opposite with this one. Okay, or this one is the combine between parallel system, two parallel system serially each other. Therefore, basically, the any system is a combination between the single server, single phase, and multi-server and single line. Therefore, we only study two of these systems. The other system, if you face in the line, you just duplicate the way. Okay, then you can come out. Okay. Now, first of all, for any queuing system, we need to know some key parameters. That is the notation systems, candle notation system for queuing systems. These are A, B, H, Y, Z. A stands for the inter-arrival time distribution, which means that the data of inter-arrival time between the customer. Example, customer number one arrive at 8 a.m. Customer number two arrive at 8:15. Customer number three arrive at 8:20. It means that the interval between customer number one and customer number two is 5 minutes. Then customer number three, let's say that 10 minutes, customer number four could be 6 minutes, and so on. We need to know the distribution of this interval time, and it will be A. Okay, this input data we need to collect in real life. Then B is the service time distribution. It means that in average, one customer, a server can serve for how long? Like the coffee shop, if one customer number one can serve for 5 minutes, customer number two can be served by 10 minutes, and so on. Okay, that is a service time. The next parameter, we need to know that how many parallel service channel, it means that how many servers we have. Number X is the number of servers. Y is limited of system population. It means that the size in queue and in service include everything. That is the maximum limitation of the system. Normally, infinity. Okay. Z is the queue discipline. It means that the rule to serve. First come, first serve. Last count, first serve, or random or priority. Okay, therefore, normally A and B could be general, could be we don't know the distribution. We just have the, let's say that the historical data, and we calculate the average values only. M is Markovian. Markovian is mean that if to the case of A, that inter arrival time, it will be follow the what? It could be the exponentials, okay? If in terms of the time, it could be the exponentials, and if in terms of the number of customer, it's in Poisson, okay? D is deterministic. This is mean that if here we put in D, it means that deterministic, the customer arrive in the constant rate. The service time is served in constant rate. It means approximately 1 hour for 10 minutes. It don't change. Okay. Then the other information we need. These are the input information. Okay. That's the populations, the input parameter. Now, the things we need to determine for a service system, first of all, number of waiting lines, okay, number of servers, the arrangement of server, parallel or serials, okay, arrival rate, service rate, okay. It's not only distribution, A and B distribution, but also the rate, it means that the mean values of that distribution, okay? The average number of customer arrive in time period, if it's Markovian, it is Poisson, the number of customer can be served per period of time, okay? Service rules, first come, first serve, and so on. Here, and the output we need to calculate. First of all, is the average number customer waiting in line. It means that the length of the line. The average time customer spend waiting, and the average time customer spend in the systems, and the system utilization rate. Okay, these are three main important parameters we need to determine. Okay. Okay, first of all, in order to solve this one, we need to consider the simplest case. That's a single server. M is mean that Markovian is mean that inter arrival time of customer is exponential, or the number of customer arrive as a Poisson. M is service time in Markovian is mean that exponential time. We have one server. And the YZ if it's not appear, it means that it default, that is infinitive. Okay. We also have assumption that customer are patient. It means that they are wait, they are willing to wait to serve. No bucking, no reneging, okay, no choking. It means that no backing. It means that customer decide not to enter the line because they see that the line is quite long. They don't have enough time to wait. For example, like the case of you go to make the ID card now to the police station, you see the line is very long. Therefore, you decide that you don't join that line today. That's a no backing. Backing. The second case is reneging. It means that the customer enter line but decide to exit before it can be served. Like the case of you make a queue to buy a ticket for the football match, and after waiting for long, you cannot be served. You tired, then you decide to quit. That is the situation that reneging. Okay, the last one is choking. It means that the case of when you make the queue, you enter to make a queue. Normally, it happens in the parallel system, multi-line system. That you make a queue, but you see that the other one, the other queue is shorter. Like when you fly from overseas around Tân Sơn Nhất Airport, at the security check, you make a queue for one counter, then you see that the next queue for the next counter is empty. Then you jump over there. That's a choking. And we assume that our system don't have this one, don't have this situation. Whenever the queue is stable, it means that the customer arrive, they are willing to wait for serve. And the line, the queue from the population that is infinite, it means that the number of customer is not limited. Okay, that is quite similar with outside. And we call that the customer arrivals follow Poisson distribution. Remember that Poisson distribution is just count the number of customer. Okay, with the mean of arrival rate in lambda, it means that in every 1 hour or 1 day or one, how many people will arrive to the line. Okay. If we measure in terms of time, time is a continuous value, therefore it's exponential. This, if you count by decreased number, that's a Poisson. This means that the time between customer arrival will be exponential with the average is 1 over lambda. You see, two things are opposite, are linked together. If we count the number of arrivals, that's a Poisson. If you count by the inter-arrival time, that's a exponential. Similar, with the service, customer service rate described by Poisson, it means that how many customers to be served in 1 hour. But if you want to measure the service time for one customer, it will be exponential, 1/me, okay? Depends on what you want, but two things are related to each other. The waiting line follow the first come, first serve rule, okay? In that case, we have the result in queuing theory that the average utilization of the system will be lambda divided by mean. It means that the number of arrival customer divided for the number of average number of customer to be served. For example, in 1 hour, the number of customer arrive is 3 people. But the capacities of your system can serve for 4 people. Therefore, the utilization is 75% only. Okay? And remember that before to calculate anything, you need to check that mi should be bigger than lambda. Okay, it means that the service capability is bigger than the queue. If the service capability less than the queue, it means that we have very long, we don't have enough capacity. We have very long queue. In that case, we don't consider. Hiếu, Đỗ Trung Hiếu, please turn off microphone. Okay, if the mean, it means that the service, the number of service people per hour or per day less than the number of customer arrive, you see that in that case, the service capacity is not enough. Therefore, for sure that for long term, the waiting will be longer. The waiting line would grow bigger and bigger. Therefore, it can cannot be served. Therefore, the condition for the system to run is the mi bigger than lambda. Okay. Then we have the other parameter we need to determine to check for the queuing system is the average number of customer in the service system, in the systems, okay? That's in L. It means that the total number of customer in the system, L is equal to lambda divided for mi minus lambda, okay? Then the other one is the average number in the queue. That's a service time multiplied with L. Utilization multiplied with L. Okay, that's LQ. The other performance could be the average time spent waiting in the system, including the service. One customer is like this. Okay. Every time spend for waiting in line. Okay, that's the waiting time. Every waiting time is P multiplied with loop liu. And the last one is not popular, but sometimes we need to calculate. That's the probability that N customer are in the service system at a given time with, if we know the historical data of the arrival. With this one, we will know that how many percentage the system are busy with the utilizations of P. Okay, so with this, to design the queuing system, therefore we need to train, okay, with the characteristic of the customers, the serve the capability of one unit of the server, we can calculate to serve for our customer populations, okay, our arrival rate. For example, if this one is small, therefore we have to increase later on, we have to increase the server, then we can reduce that one later on. Okay, now look on the example, you will know how to calculate. Actually, it's for example, in the computer lab at the State University has a help desk assistant to assist students working on computer assignments. Students patiently form a single line in front of the help desk and wait for help. Students are served based on the first come and first serve rule. On average, 15 students per hour arrive the help desk. Student arrivals are best described using the Poisson distribution. Help desk can serve, server can help an average of 20 students per hour. With the service rate being declined exponential distribution, we need to calculate the following one, the utilization first. The number of system in the student, number of student in the systems, the number of student in waiting line. You see that the number of student in the system is mean that include the wait the student in waiting line plus the student in the help desk in the server. Okay, therefore this number will be bigger than this number. The average time student spend in the system include that they are waiting for the line and include the serving time. The average time student spend waiting in line. Okay, then we need to calculate the probability that have more than 4 students in the system. Okay, now with this information, it's very easy. The first thing we need to determine lambda and mu. In this case, remember that lambda here is mean arrival rate follow Poisson. Okay, mu is mean service rate follow Poisson. Okay, if follow exponential, it is 1/1. Okay, therefore here the given information is the arrival rate is the number of students arrive to the systems. Therefore, the lambda is how much? The most difficult one here, we need to define lambda and mu only. Lambda in this case is how much? Anyone know? Lambda? And me, okay, in this case lambda how much? Lambda is 15 students per hour and it follow Poisson, therefore lambda is 15, right, students per hour. And me, Marie is cancer. The average students is 20 students per hour. Okay, if it's count based on the students, therefore that is the mean. But it say that the service rate is by exponential. It is 1/mean. It mean that mean is 20 students per hour, right? Then therefore, if we say that, okay, like this. If we would like to know how about the service rate in the exponential for me is 1/me. 1/me is 1/20, right? 1/20. So what is the unit of this one? 0.05, right? What is the unit of this one? Anyone know? What is the units of this one? Okay. So, okay, the next question is, what is the unit of 1/me? And what does it mean? Khánh Linh, Nguyễn Võ Khánh Linh, tell me please. 1/me is 0.05. So what is the measurement of this one? What should I write here? Khánh Linh. Nguyễn Võ Khánh Linh. Are you there? Hurry up. Okay, if I call you don't answer, it means that you are absent, okay? Are you there, Khánh Linh? Nguyễn Võ Khánh Linh, okay. Okay, the next one. Okay, I check. Mang.
Yes.
Okay, if I write 1/20, what is the unit should I write here?
Hour per student.
Hour per student. What does it mean?
So what one student will the time between the first student and the second student that come to the line would be
no no me 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 it's not lambda. Me is not
like so that. The service time would be 0.05.
This means that one student can be served within 0.05 hour. One student can be served in 0.05 hour. Okay, we can multiply with 60. That's a 3 minutes, something like this. Okay.
Yes.
That's the meaning of this one. Okay, we just replace. After identify that one, we can calculate the utilization easily. In this system, that is 75%. So the number of student in the system, number of student in the system will be lambda divided to me minus lambda. That is mean that. In total, we have in average we have 3 students in the system. Okay, and the waiting lines, the lineup line is around 2.25 students. Then every time student wait in the system is 0.2. It means that 20% of 60 minutes is mean that it's around 17 minutes in the system. And every time students spend in the waiting line is 15%. It means that around 10 minutes, something like this. And the probability that a student four students in the queuing line. It means that we need to calculate the P of 1 minus 1 from 1 to 4. Okay, from 0 student in the system until 4 in the system. Okay, it will be here the probability P, small p is the probability that the system, the customer will be there. Okay, one customer will be there. Therefore, it is it's around, this is somehow that's a utilization, right? That is 1 minus for 25. Then we multiply with p power n for each k. First of all, n equal to 0, therefore p power 0 is 1. P power 1 is 0.75% from this one. In power 1, power 2, power 3, power 4. Then we sum it means that 23%, nearly 24%. Okay. It means that the probability of the system have 4 students is only 25% of time only. Most of the case is 3 students. Therefore, if I, okay, you see that, come back to the example of my friend in Canada. So if he, let's say that he observed that in 1 hour, there are 15 customer arrive in the restaurants, okay? Then he, if we estimate that one customer can be served in within 10 minutes. Therefore, in average, can you tell me how many customer in his restaurant? Okay, my question is, I insert here. Now, if you are, okay, you practice. If you want to open a coffee shop, let's say like that, and you observe that the nearby coffee shop also have the follow, you go to collect the data, okay? Collect the data first, and you observe that okay, let's say that in 1 hour. In 1 hour, let's say that it have how many customer? It means that around 40 customer. It's quite busy, right? 30 customer per hour arrive to that coffee shop, and you also observe that one customer can be, let's say that, to be served in less than 5 minutes. A customer. So, if you want to open that coffee shop, you can estimate how many customer could be in your system in average. Based on that, you will estimate, okay, is the value to invest or not. That is the capacity of the system. Okay, anyone can answer to me? How many customer in the sub? How many customer in the system? In 1 hour. Okay. Can you quickly calculate for me how many in average? Let's say like this. And based on this information, you can, let's say that you can decide how big your restaurant could be. Okay, Ngô Thị Trang, that's good. Okay, now do it now and give me answer within 5 minutes. How many customer will be in that coffee shop in 1 hour. That's a very important number. You see that based on this one, we know that the capacity. And with this one, you can calculate the capacity of, let's say that the airport. Actually, that is just approximation number, but it's okay. The bus system or even the photocopy centers and even the help desk in anywhere. So with this information, can you come out how many customers in the systems in 1 hour in average? In the system in average, in average. Here, similar with our example is 3 students in the system, okay, in 1 hour. In all the time, sorry, it's not in 1 hour. In average, the system can carry around 3 students. So in this case, is how much? Anyone can answer? How many? Who come out first? I will give one bonus, 1 mark of quiz for the first one who come out correctly. Type your answer on the chat box. Oh, how in average, how many customer in the system? Therefore, in that case, you will design, okay, how the size of your coffee shop. How many? Lambda is greater than M. Okay. In that case, this is bigger than this one. How are your suggestions? It's long queue, right? Long queue, therefore, in order to increase the capacity, we have to increase the, let's say that, the number of servers to reduce that one. Okay, it's quite big. Okay, to reduce this one is mean that we, okay, that is for the parallel system later on. Now, if I reduce it to 15 customer. This is how many? 30 divided by 60 minutes is how many customer in 1 minute? So it's 0.5 customer in 1 minute. Therefore, okay, let me is let's say that I can. If in this case, if not enough, then we increase the server. Therefore, the number of service time will reduce. Let's say that to in that case is 0.5 already. Therefore, it's 0.5 also minutes or 1 minute is better. 1 minute, this is 60. Okay. So how many customer in the systems? Okay. Chung Zhang. Okay, 0.3. No, it's not 0.3. Now, if I change the data, let's say that if I have 60 customer in 1 hour, the service time is 1 minute for one customer. Therefore, the number of customer in the system is how much? Yes, already. I try to give it equally. It's 6. Equal is good enough. Therefore, it's 100%, right? Okay. Therefore, it's equal. Therefore, this L is infinity. It's very big, right? Therefore, number of customer in the system, you will see that here. Let's see. Come back to the condition. Here is lambda. It's equal. Therefore, it's infinity. Grow very big. The system can work only if we bigger than lambda. Okay. If we bigger than lambda, this one should be smaller than. This one should be smaller than this one. Okay. Or this one should be smaller. This means that 30 customer is 0.5, right? Compared to 1. Okay. If we convert back, this one is me how much? Me is 1, right? 1 customer in 1 minute. 1 customer in 1 minute. And if here we convert back to the minutes on sale, that is 30 divided to 60 minutes, that is 0.5. Therefore, in this case, now me is bigger than lambda. It's okay. So in this case, how many customer in the system in average? So we just apply, we just calculate and lambda divided to me minus lambda. Minus lambda, right? So that's one is 0.5 and divide for 0.5. That is okay, 1. So with this one, in average, the system can serve for 1 customer only. No more. If it's bigger than that, it will be overload. Okay, it's very big. Therefore, be careful. If, for example, this one is very small, let's say that it's 5 customer per hour, but the service time is very fast like this. Therefore, this one will be bigger. For example, 5. This is 5 customer. Then if we convert back is 5 customer, then 5 per minute is 5 per minute is it's very small number, right? 5 over 6. Then we divide this one. 5 over 60. 5 over 60 minus for 1 minus 5 over 60. Then this will be the big number, okay? Therefore, depends on the input parameter, we can come out how many customers to be in the system. That is the size of the system. Actually, this is a very important information for you to know the capacity of the system. But besides that, if you want to know exactly the number of customers in the waiting line, you can calculate here all the time, every time. But normally, to calculate the capacity, you should calculate this number. Now, move to the next one. Yeah, Ngoti Chang is one. Now, Wen Yi. Okay, two of you. Inot is here. Wen Yi. And Thi Chang. One. Please. Now, the next one, we continue the, actually, the, this is just very simple case, but now we need to know about the more serious, suppose that, like before, you see that, if we is very big compared to Lambda, therefore we need to increase the server. In that case, the system will be multiple servers, okay? Then by that we can increase our capacity. Therefore, the whole system is somehow is the same, except that okay we have s number of server. Now utilization, you see that we is not single million anymore. We will increase we by s multiply with we. Therefore, over there if we smaller la, we will add we until we bigger than lambda, then in that case the capacity will increase utilization. Okay, and this one probability with our customer in the setup. Okay, that's not really important, but we need to know the every customer in the systems. That's the most important thing. In order to calculate this, we need to calculate every time spent in waiting line, every number of customer in waiting line, and we have the formulas. Now, formula is more complicated because we have to calculate the probability of no customer in the system first. Then from this, we calculate the every number of customer in waiting line. From every number of customer in waiting line, we calculate the every time spent in waiting line, then every time spent in the system. Then we have the number of customer in the system. Therefore, that is the last number we need to know. This will decide the capacity of the system, right? Besides that, if we want to know the number of customer, probability of customer in the system, it's given time, it will be follow this one. Now the system is more complicated because the calculation is longer. Okay. Now, for example, in the same example, but now we have three servers. Okay. Three servers. Then the customer rate is more than before. It's 45 customers. In this of how many before? In this 15 before, right? It's three times. Okay, 45. Then the service rate is three server rate of for each of three server is it means that the service rate for one server is 18 students per hour. Therefore, we need to calculate this one. To do so, to answer this question, first of all, we have to calculate utilization. Utilization is very easy. That is 45 divided for 3 server multiplied with 18 customer per server, therefore 83%. Now, in order to calculate the size of the system, we calculate the probability of no customer in the system. That's from no server and from no server to number of server minus one. Okay, therefore it is n factorials and so on. We replace everything here. That's it. 4.5%. The probability that we don't have customer in the system. Therefore, from this one, we replace inside here. We can come out the number of system in the queue. And from this one, we can calculate the every time waiting in the queue. That's the LQ divided to lambda. And the every time students spend in the system is WQ plus 1 over me. Okay, then that's one. Then every number of system will be lambda multiplied with W, therefore 6 students. Okay, it means that this system with 3 servers can serve in average around 6 students. Now come back to the VS practice. If at the beginning I give the 5 minutes, so my question is how? What is the size of the system? In order to do so, the first step here you have 30 customers, right? At the beginning. 30 customers per hour. If we convert everything back to the same to hour, it's better. It means that me is 1/5. Okay. 5 customers. 5 minutes. Per customer. So me will be 60 divided by 5. That is how much? 10 divided by 5 is 2. 2 multiplied with 6 is 12, right? Me is 12 customer per hour. It's smaller than this one. Okay. Therefore, in this one, in order to make the system work, how many server we need? The first thing we need to increase the number of server to 3, right? S will be to make this one to be bigger than this one, 3 server. So now with this one, could you calculate for me how many customer in the system in average? I take this one here. Three server. Okay, with 3 server, how many customer in the system could be? Tung Thảo, yes. So now, I give one mark for the first one who calculate the probability of the utilization and probability of the system without no customer. Hurry up, just the first one only. Oh. Here the formula is here. And the formula here. Utilization of the system and probability of no customer in the systems. How much? Who come first? Then we start to check. I have to open Excel. Therefore, after this, you will know that factorial. Who come first? How much? Okay, Trường Giang, thank you. Let's check. Okay, 83.3% of utilization and properties. Oh, exactly the same with example. Okay, let's see. Why is the same with examples? It should be different. Three server we have 36. Is 30. Okay, now check. First of all, the P, right? P is lambda divided for S multiply with me, right? So in our case, it will be if Trường Giang is correct, then he have the mask. Okay, I don't consider the other anyone else because now we are correcting. Okay, now lambda for us is 30 divided for 3 multiplied with 12, right? That's it. Okay, that's the first one. Trường Giang is correct already. Now probability of no customer. Probability of no customer, first of all, we need to calculate the factorials, right? We have the factorial. Here we have S is 3 minus 1. Therefore, we have three things like the examples. The first one is lambda divided by V. Power of n is 0 and 0. Okay, that's the first one. The first item will be lambda divided by me power 0, right? Power 0, that is 1. 1 divided by 1 is for sure is 1, right? But therefore, I don't need to do that. The first one is 1, is 0, power n equal to 0, that is 1, okay? The next one is lambda divided by n is 30 divided by 12, okay? So n equal to 1, that is 2.5. N equal to 2, okay, N equal to 2 is this one, is 2, therefore this one is equal to 2.5, this one power up 2. Okay, that's it, 6.25 and divide by 2, okay. That's the first term because S minus 1 is maximum is 2. Therefore, we have this is divided by 1, divided by 1, divided by two factorial is 5, 2. That is 2. So here we have the result. This one divide for this one. Then we make it down. Okay, we sum it up. Sum it up all of this result. Sum of all of this. We have the first thing, the first item. The next item is the same. The next item is the same, but factorial of s. Okay. This one is, s is 3. Therefore, we have 3. S is 3. Therefore, we have the same power of here. It's better to have the formula. Now we copy this. That is 1. Is correct or not? Yeah. C no. That C 2. C 2 lambda to me power of s. Okay. Multiply with 1 over 1 minus b. This one is 1 over 1 minus b. B is here. And then I have the product. This one multiply with this one. And I sum it up both. This one plus this one. Then from this one, I take the reverse. 1 over this one. Okay? That's it because it's power minus 1. So, yeah. Oh, I forgot this one already. This is this factorial power and divide for factorial also. It's not enough. Divide for factorial. Okay, this one is divide for factorial. Not enough. Hold on. These factorials, I have to factorials. Okay. No, factorials should be here. It's better like this. Factorial of this one. And this one will be the product of this one divided to this one. Okay. I have one more thing is 1 minus for 1 minus b. This one. Both things multiply together. Both things multiply. This is the sum of all of this. It's better. I don't take the sum. Yes. Just hold on. That is this thing I multiply together. This is this one multiply with this one. That is equal to this one multiply with this one, okay? Because that is that's the first one, and the second one is the sum of this one, and both of them I sum together plus, okay? Then I take the reverse of this one. One of, okay, 44%. Okay, let's see if Jingzhen is correct or not. 4.5%. Okay, right, correct. Okay, Jingzhen, excellent. Now let me know to remember. I record it. Yeah. Trường Giang. Okay. Now continue the job for the next step. Okay, the next step, please calculate for me the average number of customer in waiting line, average number of customers spend every time customers spend in the system in the waiting lines, and average number of customer in the system. The last four step, please do it now. We have P0 already. We have P0 already, 4.5%. Now apply this one to the last four items. Average number of customer in waiting line, average time spent in waiting lines, average time spent in the system, and the average number of customer in the system. So after come out the average number of customer in the system, you can estimate that. Okay, with that customer in your system, so is enough to invest or not, and how long you can take the break even and so on. So calculate now. Then give me the final results. Oh, very fast, Hill. Win Yi. Okay, let's correct. LQ is 3.5. Okay. L, Win Yi is 2.4, but Hill is 24.4. Who is correct? Now let's check. Okay, LQ. 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 Q will be the product of P0 multiply with lambda divided by power S multiply with P. Okay, first of all, we calculate that one first. P0 is this one multiply with lambda divided by power of S. Power of S. Power of S is 3 multiply with P is here. Then the second term is h factorial 1 minus p squared, okay? H factorial equal to fact of s multiplied with 1 minus p power of 2. Okay? And two things divide each other. 3.5. Who? Let's see. We need correct the first one. Now, WQ, LQ divided to lambda. WQ Q equal to LQ divided to lambda. Lambda for us is 30, right? Yes. This one. The next one is WQ plus 1 divided to me. W equal to W plus 1 divided to me 12. Okay. The last one is L. Is lambda multiplied with me. With W. L is lambda is 30 multiply with this one. Oh, it's equal. Okay, this is 6 lambda multiply with me. Okay, now let's check your friends correct or not. Okay, W is 0.12. no, it's not correct. Nhi. WQ is 12. W is WQ is correct. W is correct. It's 0.2. But why L is 2.4? It's quite pity. It's 6. You know, it's 6. With Nhi. Okay, but anyway, to let's say that to motivate both of you still have score, Hill and Winnie. Where is score? Winnie already? Hill. Oh, Van Hill. Đúng rồi, right? And Winnie. Yeah. Thank you. Any question? That is for queuing system. It's very simple. Just only calculation. If we don't know, it's very complicated. But if you know it, it's very simple to estimate the capacity for any random system like this. You see? But you see that in real life, the people is wrong because they don't know how to, let's say that, apply the stochastic statistic knowledge in this one. Actually, queuing theory, as you study in OR2, it's just a foundation of, its foundation is from statistics only, nothing else. Okay, now we take a break. Now we take a break for 10 minutes, then we come back, okay? So we come back at 9:40, okay? Thank you. Okay, come back, please. We continue. We have finished chapter 5, the capacity planning. Now we move to chapter 6. And today we will finish the first part of chapter 6. That's a supply contract. Okay, supply contract is important also, because it helps us to design the way to working with suppliers. Okay? Because in design the supply chain, we not only choosing the facilities, but we have to also to set up the framework to work with the supplier correctly, in order to maximize profit for the supply chain. Especially for the strategic components, okay? Like key raw materials, like strategic component here actually is it should be the important components that affect on the operation of the supply chains, okay? Like key raw material, we need to set up the long-term partnership with them. The other way, the other things, we need to talk about the way how to set up the contract to coordinate the supply chains for the mode of make-to-stock or make-to-orders. Okay, how to set up the link between the components, between the supply chains. this chapter and then the next let's say that the next few chapter focus on how to link the components of the supply chain together. It will be the part of the design job. Okay. And we also study about how to make the links by a contract with the case of asymmetric information. It means that the information available for each component are not the same. For example, the relationship with supplier and the buyer, the information for the demand or for the price, selling price and so on of the market from the buyer is not shared 100% to the supplier. Therefore, we have to work, but we have to work together in that condition. That is a quite popular condition in real life. And last one, we need to study a little bit about the non-important job, but it still affect on the performance of the supply chain, that is non-strategic components. Like let's say that consumable product and so on. Therefore, in this morning, we try to finish the first two items, the contract, supply contract for strategic components and introduction. Okay, nowadays, you see that the increasing of outsourcing is quite popular because the main reason is nowadays, the specializations are more and more diversified. It means that one company cannot produce everything from A to Z. They just produce key components only, then they assemble the rest. For example, like VinFast, you see that. Actually, VinFast don't produce 100% of the car. They just, let's say that, they just assemble the car and design the car and focus on the commercial aspect. But most of their components, they outsource. Or like the case of Shanghai, it's the same, you see? They don't even, for Shanghai, they don't even design the car. They just assemble the car and focus on the sales, okay? Therefore, the procurement functions is very critical. Procurement, remember that procurement includes the purchasing plus sourcing. Okay, it's not only buying only. Therefore, for strategic components or product, we need to have very close relationship in order to reduce the risk. Because if strategic component supply have problems, the whole supply chain will be disrupted. Therefore, in order to control the relation, the link between the suppliers and the buyer, we need to have the good effect, good supply contract. So that's why we have to study here. For non-strategic component, we can purchase from different kind of suppliers easily. Therefore, it's not so difficult. It's flexible condition. Therefore, the flexibility of the market is more important than the contracts. Therefore, our main focus is how to set up the strategic contract with a key supplier for strategic components. Okay, that's the reason why we have to know. Now, basically, for strategic components, the main purpose of supply contracts in supplying strategic components is to make sure that we have to adequate supply and demand for the good. It means that we make sure that the flows of the good in the system is not interrupted. Okay, that is the main purpose. Therefore, typically, a supply contract between the buyer and supplier should be agreed on pricing and the volume for discounts, the minimum and maximum quantity is to buy, the lead time, the quality specification, and the return policy. These are the key items we need to secure. Besides that, we may, for each kind of shipment, we may have more detail like, let's say that, like the location to deliver and so on. But the most important thing is this item, because this item will affect on the performance of the supply chain in terms of the cost, in terms of profit, in terms of meeting the demand and service level and so on. Okay? So therefore, for each supply contract, the normally that is a principal contract for long terms, we need to clear for all of these items. How about pricing? What is the level of discount? What is the maximum and minimum order quantities, the lead time, and the quality specification and return policy? If not, we will face a lot of risk. For example, if we don't have return policy, in the case of the market demand go down, we keep a lot of stock, therefore we don't have the policy for return. In that case, we lost, the buyer will lose a lot of things, okay? On the quality, if we don't clear quality specification between the partners, the quality of supply is not secure. Therefore, it will affect on the final quality of the product. It affect on the our customer also. Okay? That's the meaning of this one. Therefore, whenever you work with any party, if when we discuss about the visible contract for strategic component, you should check with the checklist here. If miss anything, you need to update us immediately. Now we study different kind of strategic supply contract for important components. The first case, the most popular case is the case of we have two-stage supply chain in which we have only buyer and supplier only. The process to buy anything from buyer to supplier, we normally have to follow three main steps. The first one, the buyer will forecast the demand. Okay, you see that for us, demand is very important. We need to know the demand first from the market. Then from the demand, based on our knowledge, especially the knowledge in inventory management subject, we can determine the order quantity. Then we place an order to the supplier. Then the supplier, based on the order, then they supply to us. Remember that the order is not the principal contract, okay? The order should follow the condition in principal contract, okay? The principal contract is a framework for us to follow, and each time we place an order, we follow that one. Our main purpose is optimize profits for buyer and for supplier. Each parties only want to have the best profit. But if we look globally, we need the total profit for both sides. In that case, the relationship will be stronger. If profit is not secure for the whole supply chain, therefore the link will be easily to broken. Okay, that's the main purpose. We need to study what way in the best way in order to maintain the best profit for each party in the supply chain. Now, look on the example here. You will see that, okay, with the case of the normal supply contract, how does it work with the demand fluctuate with the demand of a certain product like this? Suppose that we forecast the demand based on historical data. We know the demand for different kind of levels with the quantities and the probability of the demand level will be here. Okay. you see that the total property is 100%, and with the level of 8,000 unit, is 11%. The next one is 11%, and so on. That is from historical data we can collect the data. And beside that, the retailing price is $125, and if we cannot sell it, the service price, service value will be $20 for the items. Okay. The wholesale price from the supplier to the retailer is $80. Okay. And the production cost, of course, of goods sold from manufacturer is $35. And the fixed cost is $100,000. Therefore, the question is how much to order. For each order, we order in terms of multiple of 1,000 units. In order to have the best profit for, let's say that for a retailer, if you are a retailer, you have to decide what is the best order quantity. And here with this information, we can see that the marginal profit for retailer will be 125 minus for 80, it will be $45 per unit. The marginal profit for manufacturer will be wholesale price is 80 minus for the cost of goods sold is also 45. But in the case of the item cannot be sell, the retailer marginal loss will be 80 minus for 20. That is 60. Okay. So with this information, the question is how much we order in order to have the maximized profit. In this case, when we are working independently, we don't care, we don't coordinate, we have just a normal contract. Therefore, everything rely on the retailer decision, okay? To do so, we have to calculate carefully, okay? We will try to figure out the profit curve. Depends on the order quantity for each side. This is the profit curve for the retailers. Okay. Now, in order to come out this one, we will try for different kind of order quantity levels like this. For example, if order quantity, we start with order quantity with 5,000, then we have to calculate the profit for retailer is how much, and so on. Then it's the same, we calculate the profit for the manufacturer. Okay, now how to calculate that one? Okay, if order quantity 5,000, you see that the profit will be calculated like this. If our order quantity is 5,000, right, then we have to check, okay, if Q is, here we have different probability of demand. We have to check with the demand levels. If Q is larger than the demand, then we will have the lost sale, right? If Q is lesser than demand, we have the full profit, correct? Okay. Therefore, we have many scenarios. Where? If Q is larger than demand level, okay, then we have the lost sale. Okay, that is for the retailer, that is 60, right? Multiply with Q minus D, right? Okay. If other case we have, we set up the formula, if Q less than D, then we have profit, right? Profit. Okay, that's a 45 multiply with what? With Q. Okay. Therefore, for each level, we will check. For example, all the quantity level, the first K, if we calculate like this, first of all, Q equal to 5,000. Q equal to 5,000. First of all, if we try with all the quantity is 5,000. Let me move everything up to have space. Now we try first. The first one. Now if Q equal to 5,000, what happened? If Q equal to 5,000, the first level of the demand will be 8,000. It's bigger, right? Demand number one is 8,000. Therefore, we have profit. One is how much? If 5,000 multiply with 45, right? Okay. And this demand is 11%, right? Our probability. Therefore, the expected demand of this one is expected profit for this one is D1 profit. I put it B for short. It's better. Expected profit P1 will be 11% multiplied with this one. Okay. This one is the result is 225, right? Okay. How much? That is. Equal to, okay, let's say calculate later on. So now with the demand of D2 is how much? 10,000, right? 10,000, we have profit P2 is also 5,000. Multiply with 45 because 10,000 bigger than this one. Therefore, expected profit of P2. I use E for short, it's better. Expected profit for P2 will be how many percent? That's 11 also. 11% of 5,000 multiplied with 45. And so on until we do it all, right? Because all of scenario we do it all, right? Until 18. The how much D here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. D6 until D6. D6 is the same. It's 18,000. Therefore, the expected profit of D6 will be the same. P6 will be how much? 10%. Then we copy this. 10%. Okay, finally, the expected profit for order quantity with 5,000 will be the sum of all of expected profit from P1 to P6, right? That's 100% of 5,000 multiplied with 45, that is 225,000 here. Okay. Now, with the second level, we try the same. 6,000. Therefore, 6,000 still less than all of this. Therefore, the same result. That is equal to the 6,000 multiplied with 45. That is 270. 77,000 is the same. Therefore, it's 15,000, okay, profit. But how about the case of 8,000? Okay, it's the same. But the case of 9,000, you see? 9,000 now, 9,000, the profit will be how much? Profit of 9,000, first of all, D1 is 8,000. It's bigger, right? Therefore, the order quantity is bigger. Therefore, its profit will be 8,000 multiplied with 45 minus for the lost sale of 1,000, right? 60. Now, P1 is not like before. Now, the profit of P1 now is 45 multiplied with 8,000 multiplied with lost sale of 60 multiplied with 1,000, right? Then we have, and finally, by that one, we continue to calculate, then the total profit is not, is a 393,045. It's not 45 multiplied with 9,000. 45, the maximum is 45 multiplied with 9,000 profit is how much? Let's calculate. Is $45 multiplied with 9,000 is 400. If we have full profit, is 405,000, right? But here, because we have some loss sale, therefore it's only 393,000 only. Okay, the way of calculation is like this. Therefore, after calculate all of other quantity levels, we try, okay? Then we come out the profit curve like this for the retailer. For the manufacturer, it's the same. We also, you see that for the manufacturer, we also calculate the same, but in for the manufacturer, we don't have lot sales. We always have profit, okay? Therefore, here for the retailer, the best order quantity will be 12,000 here. Then we will order 12,000. Therefore, in that case, the profit of a retailer is 470,700. Okay. And with this order quantity, we calculate the profit of the manufacturer is 12,000 order from the retailer multiplied with 45 profit minus for fixed cost. Therefore, we have profit of manufacturer is 440,000. Therefore, the total supply chain profit will be the sum of retailer profit and the sum of with the manufacturer profit is 910,000. We have to calculate the supply chain total profit in order to compare to the others case, because we consider the profit of the whole supply chain in order to make sure that both parties have benefit in order to, let's say that, to strengthen the relationship. If both parties have better profit, then they will follow that way. Okay? This is a simple case, the most popular case when the supplier and the retailers work independently based on their own profit process. Okay, they don't care each other. Therefore, the profit normally is 910,000 only. Okay, now, but nowadays, due to many reasons, we may have the other kind of supply contract in order to promote, to encourage each party to work better in order to gain more profit. Now the next kind of contract will be, okay, you see that if we can motivate each party, then we can reduce the risk for each party. For example, if we encourage buyer to buy more, then the supplier will have more profit, but the buyer will have the risk of overstock. But if the buyer reduce the order quantity, it will face the risk of stock out. Okay. If the supplier would like to the buyer to buy more, then they will, let's say that they have more, let's say that the out of stock, therefore it's not good for them to buy next time better. Therefore, the new concept is it's better to share the risk between both sides. Therefore, we may have the better contract between them. By sharing the risk, we can increase the profit for both parties. Therefore, both sides are happy, right? How? To do so, we the first kind of contract in order to share the risk, we call that buyback contracts. In buyback contracts, the seller agree to buy back some unsold goods from the buyer with some agreement, okay? Depends on the price. Of course, the buyback contract, the price is not the wholesale price. It should be lower than wholesale price, but bigger than service price, right? Therefore, in that case, the retailer can save the loss, okay? It means that the buyer have some incentive to order more units. That's a benefit for supplier also. And it's also benefit for the buyer when they have the discounts, when they have the buyback order, decrease the likelihood of our stock. Therefore, they reduce the probability of stock out. Okay, for the seller, they can have more profit because they can because the retailer buy more. Therefore, they have more profit. Okay, therefore both things work well. Now look in detail on the examples. Now similar with the previous example, but now the supplier, the manufacturer, willing to buy back the unsold item from the retailer with the price of $55. You see that the buyback price is less than the wholesale price, but bigger than the service price. Therefore, in this case, the profit of the retailer is still 125 minus 480. Is it 45? The profit for manufacturer is still the same. 80 minus 435 is still 45. But the loss for the retailer go down because the loss of retailer now is wholesaler price minus for 55, not minus for 20 anymore, because they can sell back with 55. Therefore, they lost only $25. It is of $60 like the reverse case. Therefore, with that one, with lower loss, the seller, the retailer willing to buy more the product. Now, apply the same case, same examples. I move it up. We will calculate more details to see that the order quantities of the retailers will be better, will be more, you see. Now it's not 12,000 anymore, it is 14,000. The retailer will buy more. And in that case, the total profit of retailer also increase to 513,000. The manufacturing also have more profit compared to the reverse case. The reverse case, this is 470 and 440 only. But in this case, it's increased to 513 and 470, okay? Therefore, the whole profit of supply chain will be better. Okay, the detailed calculation is the same way. Okay, for example, if I check with this one, right? The order quantities, you can check the way of calculation exactly the same. If the demand, the order quantity, I order, let's say that 13, right? Then I will check with the first level of demand. D1 is 8,000, right? Then I have profit P1 will equal to 8,000 multiplied with 45 minus 4. The loss now is how much? The loss now, unit loss now is not 60 anymore, it's 25, okay? It's 25 multiplied with, let's say that 13,000 minus for 8,000, okay? Then we have the low, the more profit than before. Then with this profit, we multiply with probabilities of 8,011. Okay, that's expect profit. Okay, we can bring it here to how much? That's D1. Then we calculate D2 and sum it up together. That's it. 235,000. Then we have expected P1 is 11% multiplied with 235,000, right? Then it is 11% multiplied with this one is 2,850. 2,850. Okay. Then we repeating for the next level of demand and sum it up together. We have this one. 530. With this level, we can calculate the manufacturing profit by multiplying with this one together with 45 minus for 100,000 totally. Then manufacturer profit is always increasing, but the retailer profit is going down. Okay, you see that? Okay, that is the way. Therefore, you see that with the buyback contracts, the profit is better. Therefore, if you know this one, it's better to persuade your strategic partner, okay? You should follow this game. Then both parties have the more profit. Besides buyback contracts, you see that buyback contracts, that's the advantage of buyback contracts. Profit for both parties is better, but it still have some limitation. The first limitation from the supplier side, it means when the supplier side, when they buy back, they have to process the buyback item, right? It means that recycle, retrofit, and something else. Therefore, they have to invest something more. It's more cost. That's a limitation of buyback contract. It's increase its logistic cost, right? For the retailers, right? When they sell the other competing product, they have an incentive to push product which are not under buyback contract due to higher risk. Therefore, for the retailers, if we have, for example, for this item, they have buyback, therefore it's safe for them. Therefore, they try to, if they sell many products together, even the competitor product, they don't promote for this one to sell because they are safe. If they cannot solve it, they can sell it back. Therefore, they promote to sell more the one who don't have buyback. Therefore, the let's say that the revenues of this one, the quantities for demand of this one could go down. Okay, not like before. If in this case we assume that okay, the demand is the same, right? But in practice, if we have the buyback, the demand level here could go down compared to the non-buyback because the risk is higher. The retailer focus on selling the higher risk item. Okay, that's the disadvantage of this one. like this one, okay, like the book and magazines in the office, okay. But by the way, that limitation is not for long term for the suppliers, not so much. But for this one, we okay. This is also we can overcome by, let's say that, to guarantee to have some more condition that you have to sell at least how many levels. Then I will apply the buyback condition. Okay. Now the other way, in order to improve the profit for both parties, that the revenue sharing contracts. Okay. The people recognize that one reason the buyer to order limited quantities because the wholesale price is quite expensive. If the wholesale price is expensive, then they don't want to order so much, right? Therefore, if the wholesale price go down, the buyer will buy more, right? But when the wholesaler go down, for the supplier's profit go down because the profit unit less. Therefore, it's under to sell more unit. Therefore, in order to overcome this one, we should have some sharing revenues. It means that by in terms of the discount scheme. For example, suppliers say that if you can sell more than 10,000 units, I will discount for you 10%. By that way, the buyer order quantity will improve on sale, but the profit of supplier still be secure. Therefore, that is the way that we transfer a portion of revenue from each unit profit sell out to share back to the supplier. Okay, that's the normal way to in practice. For example, here, the same examples. Now, the wholesaler price go down for 60, it's not 80 anymore. So the profit of retailers is 65, but the manufacturer profit go down 25 only, not 45 anymore. But when they agree that if they can share back 15% of revenue, it means that some kind of share back the profit, okay? In that case, in a certain levels, then the loss of this one is 40 only. That's the loss here now is 40, but sharing 15% of revenue. Now, to see that, with the same way of calculations, when we calculate this one, when we calculate the profit of this one, for each level, we need to subtract to 15% of revenues. Whenever we sell out, for example, 5,000, it's not like before. The retailer profit in before is how much? It's 225, right? Then in that case, we can order more than the total profit will be increased. Order quantity will be more because now, because of the unit profit is bigger, right? If we multiply with 5,000, is how much? 65. Originally, if it's 5,000, is less than the demand. Therefore, it's always profit is better. It's 65, 325, right? 325. But now we have to deduct for 15% of revenues on sale. Therefore, we have lower profit here. It's only 231,000 only, not like before. Okay, it's not like the original one. Originally, if we don't have the sharing values, we get the profit of 325,000. But now with sharing profit, the sharing revenues, if we return back the revenue of 15%, then it's go down to 231. Okay. then it's lower, but because we have more profit, therefore we want to order more, and normally the profit even for here is go down, but here if we can order more, therefore it's better than before. You see that the total profit is 550,000. In this up 513,000 of buyback contract, even better than okay. For manufacturer, in this case, it's not good as before, and the buyback improve a little bit, but not so much compared to the buyback contract, but it still have improved compared to the last time, even though the order quantity for both case are the same. You see, it's 14,000. For the previous one, it's 14,000. But now, even the wholesale price go down $20. But with this agreement, the manufacturer still have more profit than before a little bit. Okay? Therefore, compared with the buyback contract and revenue sharing, this one is better. Okay. But it still have limitation. You see that here it depends on the revenues. And this can work when the retailer share the correct revenue number. But normally in practice, it's difficult to know exactly, because that's a business secret of retailers, right? Therefore, this system can work only they have the trust each other. Supplier have to monitor the buyer revenue, okay? Because if the retailer cheating, right? Instead of selling 14,000 product, they report that they sell only 10,000 product. Therefore, 50% here go down. Okay, therefore the supplier has to monitor the buyer revenues. Therefore, they have to pay more administration costs. On the other case, this system can work when both them can trust each other, but in real life, it's difficult. Really difficult. The other thing is information technology is not enough. Therefore, building the trust between supplier and buyer is not only important but also difficult to achieve. Very, very difficult. When the retailer have more incentives to push competing product with higher profit margin, since under revenue sharing contract, the retailer profit margin is reduced. You see that. The margin reduced for each level. Therefore, they refer to buy the competing contract, even though finally they have to sell more. Okay, therefore the effort from them to promote to sell each product is limited compared to the higher risk, similar with the buyback contract. Okay, buyback contract can do if the supplier have the recycled product, the reverse logistics system, the revenue sharing contract, if both of them have a good trust each other, good relationship each other, okay, even though both of them are the good one. Now, we have another one, that's a quantity flexibility contract. That is quite popular in real life. It say that that's a kind of discount scam. It say that supplier provide full refund for unsold product as long as the number of return less than a certain limit level. Okay. It's similar with the buyback contract, but now the buyback price will be the same with the wholesale price. Of course, this is a limited number of return only, not so much, not the whole thing. Because if you don't limit it, the retailer always return all of them. They are unsold. It's not good at all. Okay. Therefore, in this one, somehow that okay, you can help the manufacturer can help the retailer to sell more, and both of them have profit together. Then I leave it for you to check with the same example to see that the profit, the total profit of supply chain improve or not compared to the other one. For example, you fix that, okay, the return product is less than 1,000 unit. You can verify back, okay, is it better than or not. Besides that, we have the other one, like sell rebate contract, it means that the discount, okay. This means that provide direct incentive of retailer to increase sale by means of rebate pay by supplier for any item to sell. For example, that is quite popular in real life also. The manufacturer say that if you can line my case before, normally our demand is around 3,000 ton per month. And the supplier say that if you, let's say that you can order 1,000 ton per month, I will give you free of charge, let's say that 300 ton. It means that discount 30%. By that way, the supplier encourage the retailer to sell more in order to get a promotion, okay? It means that we have the incentive for meeting the sale target. That's the quite popular one, okay? In summary, we have four kind of contract in order to link between the party in the supplier supply chain parties. And even though the other supply contract is better than the original one, the normal contract, independent contract, but they have still some limitation. Therefore, in real life, the people try to apply this one, okay? Try to apply this one to get profit, to overcome the limitation. And the last one is the global optimization. Give me a few minutes more, I will finish the one. This can happen when supplier and buyer in the same organization because they can share information each other 100%. They are the same situation, same process. Therefore, the decision are the common decision for both of them. This condition is quite difficult, but it's okay. And they are working together. Then in that case, that's the best scenario, but it's not easy to apply in real life. For example, the manufacturer wholesale price here is the same. And the information from both of them are sharing together 100%. Therefore, the real supply chain, now we consider the real supply chain profit, not the profit for each company, each party. The real supply chain profit is 125 minus to go to off zone only, it's $90. And the supply chain loss is $35 only, not 20, okay? 35 minus for 20, that's the service, is $15, okay? It's reduced a lot because we had to pay, the worst case, we had to pay only this one and we can recover back $20. Therefore, we lost only $15, not so much. Therefore, the whole supply chain have a lot of profit if they are the same owner. They are the same owner between the supplier and retailers. Then the therefore the normally in this situation the supply chain normally produce more than the average of demand. Average of demand here, the mean of this one, for example, in this case, is average demand is how much? For this one, you take the mean of this one, normally the supply chain will produce more quantities than mean of that one. Yeah. You can verify by, you see that 16,000 in this case. They will order more and more. And in that case, it's the best, perfect one. But you see that it's difficult to perform that because they are in one system, therefore they have surrender decision making power to unbiased decision maker, allocate supply chain, it don't allocate the profit for each partner, therefore no motivation for each one. Okay, that's it for today. So in summary, this is an ideal condition, but somehow in real life is almost impossible to apply. This one we call the centralized control. Okay, centralized control situation. It's just a benchmark, like optimal solution on we often saw in our mathematical models. It's an ideal case, but it's difficult to achieve. It's just a benchmark to compare the other case. The most popular one are this one, buyback, sharing revenue, quantity flexibilities, and sell rebate. Okay, that's a four popular contract to link each other. Okay, that's it for today. Any questions? Oh. I did not upload this one. Okay, sorry, I will send it to you now. Anything else? So after this, I will ask the TA will post for the homework for the last chapters, the remaining part of the last chapters, then try to finish it next week. Okay. Okay, thank you. If you don't have any question, I will leave now. Bye-bye.